We have on the line Professor Danilo Arau, convener of Contra Dayaw. Arau is an associate professor at the College of Mass Communication in the University of the Philippines, Diliman. Professor, thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon to you, Denise, and to all our televiewers.
Now, Professor Jeffrey Saliz mentioned, is claiming that Contra Dayaw is a CPP project being used to manipulate electoral public opinion. You know, what is Contra Dayaw?
Contra Dayaw was established in 2007 at the height of the so-called Hello Garci scandal. It's composed of students, teachers, IT professionals, and other concerned groups and individuals who would want to establish a watchdog meant to monitor various forms of election fraud and irregularities. Our challenge to Mr. Saliz at this point would just be summed up in two words: prove it. Otherwise, all of his accusations would not fly. And we criticize also the Philippine News Agency for using very valuable government resources for, you know, spinning such lies. That's all there is to it. It is disinformation at its finest, and it's a highest form of disinformation as well.
What is the implication of this, Professor? That is quite alarming. You said so yourself, that a government news agencies being used as a perpetrator, as a messenger, to be able to convey these accusations that haven't been proven just yet.
Well, it goes to show that PNA has no concept of journalism whatsoever, which is very, very unfortunate, because just for the record, they used to consult me on how to properly reorganize the Philippine News Agency. And it's a matter of public record. Martin Andanar was the one who invited me there in the past. And right now, it's disappointing that many of my recommendations are being ignored, and they're now being used, ironically, for propaganda, not just against me, but against legitimate critical dissent, against the government. So that kind of editorial independence is very much thrown out the window. And right now, the level of logic is within the realm of the multiverse of madness. So it's hard to make sense of that kind of journalism. And our only conclusion is that they're not engaging in journalism at all, but merely black propaganda against legitimate dissenters.
And what does this mean for press freedom if there is no journalistic integrity when it comes to the highest form, when it's the government news agency themselves?
It is a reflection of the pretentiousness that is very much inherent in all government media, not just the Philippine News Agency, but also PTV. And perhaps on another level, we can also include here SMNI, which also aired certain claims, false claims of Saliz, as well as those identified with the MTF-ELCTA. We've been red tagged, by the way, Denise, not just now, but even in the past. So these red tagging agencies, whether they're government or private organizations, they should put a stop to it, because they're putting the lives of people in danger. So this is my warning to Mr. Saliz. If anything happens to any of our volunteers, to any of my family members, to any of my relatives, or even to me, it's all on you. And I hope you can sleep soundly at night, you know, telling all those lies publicly.
Now, Professor Arau, I sense your frustration, and we've, you know, covered quickly how this affects press freedom, journalistic integrity. But some people can be, I guess, quite not aware of the situation, how dangerous this could mean for them. So if you could explain it to them, I guess, also what this would mean also.
Okay, let me cite certain anecdotal evidence. At least two journalists have been red tagged. Two of them have been detained, and one of them is still in detention right now. I can just name for quick discussion, Icy Salen, who was imprisoned in December and was released March last year. And then we have also Frenchie May Compio, who's still in detention. She was arrested February 2020. And right now, she's still in jail. And of course, there are other red tag people. I personally know Randy Malayaw is one of them, who was killed while on board a bus going back to his province. Randall Echanis, was already 70 years old. He was also red-tagged, and then but after that he was tortured before being killed somewhere in Novaliches. Zara Alvarez, a human rights defender, was also found murdered, and she was also red-tagged. So these are just some examples of people who had been red-tagged in the past, and right now they're not with us anymore. So red-tagging really means that there is already a target on your back. So there is reason to worry about such accusations, because these are not just simply words. These are words that carry with them the probable bullets that would hit you in certain parts of the body.
Now, journalists are quite in hot water when it comes to, of course, reporting the truth that some people don't even think it is. And not just local journalists, but also foreign journalists as well. We've had the FOCAP also complaining that they've been in the receiving end of threats of some Marcos supporters pre-election results. What is the future of journalism and the future of journalists if so early on during the start of a new administration, this is what is welcoming them?
The challenge for journalists right now is to always engage in truth-telling. However, reaffirming the principles of truth-telling, like factual accuracy and contextual accuracy, would just be one dimension of the task at hand. The other important task, and I should say that this is perhaps equally important to the routines of a journalist, would be to help defend press freedom. That's where the principle of freedom and stewardship would come in, for the simple reason that we cannot allow curtailment of our basic freedoms, including freedom of expression and freedom of the press. So that's one dimension of the story, Denise. However, we also need to call out certain news media organizations like the Philippine News Agency and the SMNI for engaging in red tagging. And lest I forget, I also need to include here the tabloid Remate, which reprinted hook, line, and sinker, practically the article of PNA, and just translated it in Filipino. That kind of journalism should not be implemented. In fact, as I said a while ago, it's not journalism at all when instead of shaping the minds of people, you end up poisoning them with the highest form of disinformation, which is red tagging. Again, red tagging has no room in responsible journalism.
Now, what news agencies, or rather agencies, whether government or non-government, can be able to protect those who are being accused of being communists?
Of course, the protection would be the truth. I mean, of course, for example, with the likes of ANC, when you invited me here to talk about red tagging, I know fully well that you're not there to accuse me openly of red tagging, because I know the reputation of this particular news media organization. So I guess emulation or stewardship would be the order of the day here. We are not lacking in terms of responsible and reputable journalists, media workers, and news media organizations. It's just a matter of identifying them and not being identified with the irresponsible ones. And again, we identify them, PNA, SMNI, and Remate. So thank you very much for red tagging Contradaya, because you've exposed the kind of, you know, black propaganda that you are. And you do not deserve to be in the company of responsible journalists.
Professor Aro, also just I want to get your comment. You know that, of course, the new administration, presumptive President Bongbong Marcos and also presumptive Vice President Sara Duterte Carpio, their campaign really hinges on unity. Do you think that unity will be able, I guess, to be achieved if everything will be in favor of them? We've also been reporting that also in the Congress, there isn't enough checks and balances in the senatorial, not enough opposition. So what's the position of democracy here, of all for the sake of unity?
We have to be on guard, because that kind of unity is all a myth. As you correctly noted, it's just the unity of a particular class that supports the administration. Right now, checks and balances are practically absent, because you have not just a majority rule in the executive branch, but also the majority control in the legislative, as well as even in the judiciary, because we have to remember that those appointed by Duterte in the judiciary would still tend to gravitate toward the current administration. So that kind of a scenario puts the media as the fourth estate in a more you know, pressure-laden situation. You cannot, you know, give up on the check and balance function of the media. And we need the media more than ever to be the critical voice, to be more specific, to remain as the voice for the voiceless, instead of pretending to be neutral in the, but actually you'll end up supporting the powers that be. Because make no mistake about it, the tendency for authoritarian rule is always present when you have a populist leader who would try to get his or her way just to achieve the goal of perpetuating themselves in power. They've planned this for quite a long time now. They've made a comeback, and we have to make sure that we will make, you know, certain amends to whatever shortcomings there may be during the election. So that's why we need to always be on guard to ensure that democracy will be protected, because there will be certain segments of the population, particularly those who are in power, who would try to compromise democracy as we know it. They will try to be authoritarian and they will call it democracy. So a reversal of the vocabulary would be part of their agenda. And maybe they'll try to reinvent the dictionary while they're at it.
Professor Danilo Arao, convener of Contradaya. Professor Arao, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much, Denise.